Assalamu alaikum guys, today we are going to be continue our design of the steel bridges. Today we will going to be start with the distribution of the live load. So once we are need to design any bridge deck slab or any other component of the bridge, steel bridge, then we need to be distribute the loads. Okay, so if the live loads be there in the form of plane load or in the form of circular loads, then these are needed to be distributed along the length or along the lateral direction. So how we are going to be considering this distribution of the live load, we will discuss in these slides. The truck loads on the bridge deck are moving at the different locations along the width and length of the slab. So as we are going to be familiar with this fact, this is the bridge deck and the truck load is needed to be considered. It is going to be having two axle and each axle is going to be comprises of two wheels. This completely one set of four wheels are going to be put a load, this live load, on this bridge deck. So you are not going to be, it will not be sufficient or will be going, it will not be enough to consider only along one direction the vehicular loads, mean live load. So it is going to be distributed, it is needed to be distributed along the length and along the width, mean in the lateral direction also. So for this particular case, how to be considered the effect of each directional load during the design, that what's very important. Okay, so when these loads occupy a certain critical position, the maximum forces occur in the member. That is going to be calculated with the help of influence line diagrams. That if the loads, mean the vehicular loads, the wheel loads has been applied along the length of the bridge deck in the one direction only. Okay, so what we need to do, we need to be apply these loads and then the maximum effect of the forces we have to be considered, and the position where we are going to be placing this vehicular loads, and then we are getting the maximum forces in the member. And then for these maximum forces we need to design. This is the part of analysis, and once the maximum forces will be known to us, then we can design our member based on these maximum force values. So for the approximate design of the deck, usually one dimensional analysis is carried out considering only the girder, only one direction. If the deck is needed to be designed, then along the length, mean here if girders has been placed, then along the length only in one direction we are going to be consider the analysis. This is called as approximate analysis, mean approximate design of the deck. And for this approximate design of the deck, we need the one dimensional analysis only along one length, that is along the girder. Okay, if this is required, then how to get the effect of the live loads from the lateral direction, because its effect is also in the lateral direction, in the other direction. So how to get that, how to shift or how to transfer, how to get this equivalent load, live load effects from the lateral direction and need to be converted, need to be shifted along the length to get the or to do the one dimensional analysis. In such cases, it become very important to find the effect of the loads along the so estimating the contribution of the transversely placed loads with respect to direction of the traffic movement over the center line of a particular member spanning along the length of the bridge is called lateral distribution of the load. This is technical definition. Okay, so if this is the girder that is placed along the length, spanning between the abutments or between the piers, then this is the center line of this girder. And you are estimating the contribution of the transversely placed loads. So transversely placed load mean along this direction and along this direction. So its contribution of the loads, those has been placed in transverse direction along the center line, over the center line of a particular member that is spanning along the length of the bridge. Okay, that is going to be called as the lateral distribution of the loads. So finally, the load has been transferred along the length of the, meaning along the longitudinal direction of this particular member. That may be girder, may be stringers, okay, or may be bridge deck itself. Thus, by the lateral distribution, equivalent loads are obtained at the member. That you have to be remember. Wherever in the analysis or the design, we talk about or we will see this word equivalent loads. What does it mean? This equivalent loads mean that you have considered the estimated contribution of the transversely placed loads in the longitudinal direction, and that is going to be called as the lateral distribution. Okay, so lateral distribution of the loads has been done, and whatever the value or the amount of the loads you have been calculating by the lateral distribution, this is called the equivalent loads. So equivalent loads has been placed along the center line of the member that is spanning along the length of the bridge. Maybe girder, maybe bridge deck, maybe stringers. Floor beams are not those members. Floor beams are placed in the lateral direction. Okay, so you cannot use this term, lateral distribution of the loads. Okay, so for that, another criteria has been done, mean reverse of that has been done, and we will discuss it later on. These equivalent loads are then placed along the length of the member according to the criteria of the maximum forces, mean by using the influence line diagram in case of the moving loads. So your equivalent loads are then placed along the length of the member. So first of all, for the longitudinal members, you have to do the lateral distribution of the loads in the form of equivalent loads. This loads has been placed along the length of the member, and then you have to be calculate the maximum effect, maximum forces in case of moving loads by using the influence line diagram concepts. So maximum force effects are then obtained from this longitudinal distribution of the load. So this step, whatever you have been doing, in this particular step, it is going to be called as longitudinal distribution of the load. So what does it mean? That for all of the members of the bridge, those are spanning along the length of the bridge, you have to do first the lateral distribution of the loads, and then you have to do the longitudinal distribution of the loads. These are the two step-by-step procedures for the analysis. To make you better understand, here in the schematic view has been drawn over here. This is the lateral, you can say, view, the cross-sectional view, you can say. So here you can see the cross-section has been drawn. So in this particular way, this all blackish part is going to show you the bridge deck. Okay, and below that, two main girders has been placed at the extreme corners. Okay, extremes, you can say, sides on right and left. Two girders has been placed, and in between the two girders, this 1, 2, 3, 4 stringers has been placed. Okay, and here you can see another cross-sectional view of an I beam. This is actually a floor beam. In this particular direction, this floor beam is not, you can say, considered when you are talking about the lateral distribution at first and then longitudinal distribution. These are the floor beams. So if you talk about the deck, then deck is going to be also incorporating the barrier. Okay, so this is going to be called as bridge deck barrier. So if we are going to be take the clear span from the start of the barrier, edge of the barrier, then this is the roadway width. The roadway width is the clear span in between the clear edge of the bridge deck barrier. So in between the barriers, this is called as roadway width. Complete is the deck. Okay, this is complete deck, I have told you. Okay, so if the clear span has been, mean clear width has been taken out from the edge of the barrier inside of the deck, it is going to be called as roadway width. Okay, so it may be having any number of the lanes, we have to be, we have been discussing in the last lectures that in between the roadway width, the number of the lanes you have to be calculate later on. How much are, how many are the number of lanes? Okay, so below this bridge deck, you can see the girders, two main girders has been placed, and in between the stringers. So the stringer spacing will be the center of the stringer, two consecutive stringers will be the stringer spacing. And girder spacing are from center to center of these two girders. It will be the girder spacing. Okay? So if this is the particular case and you want to draw a plan view of these, then you can see this type of the arrangement. This is the main supporting element. This is the center line of the main supporting element that has been drawn very clearly. Okay? And here you can see the dash lines for the stringers. Here the discontinuity you use for the stringers. Here it is not discontinued. What does it mean? Because your main supporting elements are the string, are the girders. So what is the flow of the load, transformation, transfer path? Okay, for this, if we talk about the load transfer path, what is the path of the load transformation, how the load transfers? Okay, so this will be from the bridge deck, the load comes first of all at the stringers. From the bridge deck, from the moving vehicles, the load comes on the bridge deck. From the bridge deck, the load comes on the stringers at first, the longitudinal members. From the stringers, load has been transferred towards the floor beams, because here the discontinuity has been shown. So discontinuity mean that the main supporting element for the stringers are the floor beams. So load from the floor beams in the longitudinal direction has been transferred from the stringers, has been transferred to the floor beam. And these floor beams are resting on the main girders. Then in the lateral direction, from the floor beams, load has been transferred towards the main girder. Now your main girder has been resting on the piers or any other supporting foundation, abutments or whatever. So here, from the main girders, there is no interruption in between. Directly from the main girder, load has been transferred towards the foundations in the form of piers, in the form of abutments, whatever the case is. Okay? From the transom. Transom is also an in-between part. We will discuss it later on at the end when we will be doing the design example problem. There we will discuss that what transom is. So here for your scope of the work, transom is not needed to be designed. Okay? But it is also a part of the bridge. Sometimes it will be there, sometimes it will not. Directly your main girder is resting on the piers or abutments. Okay? So here you have, for this particular case, you have the main supporting elements girder. So what is the load path? From the deck, load has been transferred towards the stringers. From the stringers to floor beams, and from the floor beams, girders, and from the girders to foundation, directly, whatever the type or kind of the foundation is. So this is the load transfer path, okay, for this particular case. So this is the particular case, then what we need to be designed after the bridge deck, mean including the bridge deck. What are your longitudinal members? Your stringer is a longitudinal member. Your bridge deck is a longitudinal member along the direction of the traffic. This is the traffic flow direction, let's suppose, in either A. And your main supporting member, girder, is a longitudinal member. And lateral member is the floor beam. Okay? So, whatever we have been discussed in the last slide is applicable for the members. Those are longitudinally placed. Okay, those are spanning along the length of the bridge. For that, the very first step is, for the analysis, one-dimensional analysis, first of all, you have to do the lateral distribution of the live load, and then you are going to be calculating the equivalent loads by the lateral distribution of the loads, live loads. These equivalent live loads has been placed along the center line of the longitudinal member, and then the analysis has been done for the maximum forces, and that calculation of the maximum force effects is going to be called as longitudinal distribution of live load. Okay, so first of all you have to do the lateral distribution and then longitudinal distribution. Now we talk about the members. Those are considered or placed transverse to the traffic direction. Okay, so the beams, however, for the beams or the slab strips, the slab is also two-dimensional element. You are familiar with this fact. You have I think done in PRC 2 the slab design for houses. ठीक है, house के लिए जो आपके होते हैं slabs, उनकी डिज़ाइनिंग आप डी डी एम मैथड से और एक दो और मैथड्स होंगे, एक कुछ कुछ और होते हैं हमारे yield line methods, वो हम आपके एम एस सी में करवाते हैं, स्पेशलाइज्ड वन. ओके, यू हैव डन ऑलरेडी दैट योर स्लैब इज अ टू डायमेंशनल मेम्बर. ओके, सो फॉर दैट वट यू हैव टू डू इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डिज़ाइन योर स्लैब एंड यू वॉन्ट टू डिज़ाइन इट्स री इन्फोर्समेंट इन टू डायमेंशंस, देन यू हैव टू बी कंसिडर फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल द स्लैब स्ट्रिप्स. ओके, इन वन डायरेक्शन एंड देन इन द अदर डायरेक्शन, एंड यू हैव टू अप्लाई द लोड्स इन बोथ ऑफ द डायरेक्शंस, एंड यू हैव टू कैलकुलेट द री इन्फोर्समेंट इन बोथ ऑफ द डायरेक्शन. So the similarly, if the bridge deck slab is needed to be designed and the reinforcement needed to be designed in both of the directions, then you have to be consider the first longitudinal strip, considering your slab as a longitudinal member, and then you can design or you can do the analysis for the slab that for analyzing or to considering its slabs placed in the lateral direction, in the transverse direction. Okay, so for that again you have to be design its reinforcement. Floor beams, for the beams mean the floor beams are already in the lateral direction, we have discussed. Okay, so for these type of the beams, those are placed transverse to the traffic direction in the lateral direction, and the slab strips you are considering during the design of the slab in the lateral direction, first of all you have to do the longitudinal distribution, reverse of that. Okay, the longitudinal distribution of the load is to be performed first to get the equivalent loads. Okay, so these equivalent loads, now after the longitudinal distribution of the loads, these equivalent loads are then placed transversely at a suitable location to get the extreme forces. Again, ILDs, by considering the concept of the ILDs, the position and the value, the amount of the forces, the maximum effects of the forces. This method of performing a manual 1D analysis is called as approximate method of analysis. You have to be keep remember, okay, that the approximate method of the analysis is a one-dimensional analysis in which you are doing or you are getting the equivalent effect, or you are calculating the equivalent loads. If it is a longitudinal member, then equivalent loads are calculated by considering the first of all the lateral distribution of the loads and then longitudinal, and in case of the members, those are placed in transverse direction, in lateral direction, then first longitudinal distribution of the live loads has been done, and then you are getting the equivalent loads from those and placing in the lateral direction by doing the lateral distribution, and finally you are doing this 1D analysis to called as approximate method of analysis. Now continuing with the conditions, the beams should be parallel and should have approximately the same stiffness. The roadway part of the overhang DE does not exceed 9-10 millimeter. Okay, so overhang part, roadway part, that is from the center of again, if we are going to draw the cross section, this is bridge deck including the barrier. So let's suppose if you have been placing the girder over here, plate girder, then this will be the overhang part from the center of the girder till the edge of the barrier. Okay, so this will be DE. So this DE, this overhang part, does not exceed 9-10 millimeter. The given expressions are only applicable to the concrete deck on steel or concrete beams. Okay, so if the concrete deck is placed on the steel or the concrete beams, then you are going to be use the following given expression. We will discuss ahead. So before discussing the expressions used for the analysis purpose, first of all we have to be familiar with the notations used in these expressions. These notations are the small g. This is the distribution factor. That's what I have told you, that first of all you have to do the lateral distribution and then you have to calculate the equivalent loads. So to get the equivalent loads, that distribution factor from the lateral loads or from the longitudinal loads, that is going to be called as g. This small g is needed to be calculated, and then further with the particular loads, this distribution factor needed to be multiplied to get the equivalent loads. Okay, capital S, the spacing of the beams or webs, capital L, span of the beam, small n, modular ratio between beam and deck materials if those are different. Okay, there are two cases. One is that you have a bridge deck slab and you have monolithically placed the stringers or the beams, concrete beam, and you have the bridge deck in cross section. Okay, you have bridge deck slab above, this is the bridge deck slab. Okay, and monolithically the concrete beams has been casted and connected with the bridge deck slab. Okay, so these are monolithically connected beams, stringers or the girders. Second case is the composite structure, the composite steel bridge R, in which the deck slab has been casted separately as of concrete and it is resting on the steel beams, steel plate girders or the stringers. Okay, so these are of steel and this is of concrete. So this is the particular way. There is of course a connection mechanism for the composite structures. I am not going to be discuss it in detail to avoid the confusion at this particular step. Okay, but just you have to be clear this thing, that your concrete beams are connected with the your steel beams are connected with the concrete deck slab. This is called composite steel bridge and this is called simple concrete bridge. Okay, so concrete bridge mean the slab is also of concrete and monolithically the beams are connected with the slab, but here your slab is resting on the girders, steel girders and the steel stringers inside also here. Okay, so if this is the particular case, this one composite structure, then of course there will be a difference between the material of the beam and the slab, girder and the slab. So if this is the particular case, stringers and the slab, floor beam and the slab, okay, whatever the cases are. So if your beam and the deck material are different, it is a composite bridge, then what you have to do, you have to calculate the modular ratio also, and it is also going to be effect in the expressions to calculate the lateral distribution or the longitudinal distribution factors. NB is the number of the beams, stringer or the girder. TS is the depth of the concrete slab in millimeters. Capital I is the moment of inertia of the beam. EG, G is in subscript, it is the distance between the centers of the beam and the deck. Okay, so if this is the slab center line and this is the beam center line. So this is going to be called as PG. So considered zero for the non-composite beam. Okay, so there will be no concept. You can calculate exactly the moment of inertia for this section. Okay, effective section. So if it is the whole concrete bridge, then this is also concrete, this is also concrete. So if it is required to calculate the moment of inertia, then the effective part of the bridge deck can be considered, and also within along the length and along the width. Okay, so this part has been considered to calculate the moment of inertia for the beams in analysis. But if it is non-composite, then of course you have to be shift, because the moment of inertia for the steel part will be different and for the concrete part will be different. So you have to be shift the moment of inertia from steel to deck slab, from steel beams to deck slab. So for that, this particular distance matters a lot. Capital A is the area of the stringer, beam or the girder. Now continuing with the notations, then comes kg. Okay, so this is equal to small n I plus a e g square. That's what I have telling you. Okay, that you have to shift in case of the composite steel bridges, you have to be shift the moment of inertia. So this is the longitudinal stiffness parameter. Kg is the longitudinal stiffness parameter, that is the moment of inertia of one beam modified to the equivalent concrete section and transferred to a point at the center of the slab. So this capital I will be the moment of inertia of the beam itself, and once you are getting the area and mean the moment of inertia for the AEG square, okay, once the beam moment of inertia, it will be from the center of the beam itself here. So capital I you can calculate by considering or by shifting the moment of inertia at the center. It will be capital I, center of the beam itself. Now if the concrete deck slab has been placed above, okay, and this is of concrete, then of course from the center of the slab you have to shift it. Okay, so you have to make an equivalent moment of inertia. Just to that you have to be add this particular moment arm and this moment of inertia, you have to be added into it. So it is going to give you with the ratios of the modular ratio in the stiffness of the modulus of elasticity, the ratio of the modulus of elasticity of the steel, this material, beam material, and the deck material. So this modular ratio with the ratio of this ratio of the modulus of elasticity of these two different materials, the moment of inertia has been shifted or has been calculated as an equivalent one with respect to the concrete section. Okay, and it is needed to be transferred at the center of the slab, so that you are going to be get the effect of this connection, okay, of the beam with the deck slab. Kg over Lt s cube, this is a parameter proportional to the ratio of the beam stiffness to the total slab stiffness in transverse direction at the level of the slab center line. So once at the center line you have been in the in that particular direction from the beam you have been shifted, now in the lateral direction you have to shift the stiffness. Okay, so in the lateral direction this can be shifted with the ratio of the beam to the slab stiffness itself, LTS cube. What is DE? We have discussed earlier also, this is the distance between the center of the exterior beam and the interior edge of the curb or the traffic barrier. It shall be taken positive if the exterior web is within the roadway inside the curve, and negative when it is outside the roadway. So what does it mean? In the next slide we will discuss. So this DE is the this is the exterior girder, main girder. Okay, so this girder has been placed within the roadway, and this is the edge of the curve. Okay, this is the roadway barrier and this is curve, this is edge of the curve. So main roadway has been started from here. Okay, so if your girder DE is the distance between the center of the girder to the edge of the curve, within the expressions wherever DE has been used, it is considered as positive if it is inside the curve. Okay, this one, if your exterior girder is inside the curve, this is total curve width, from here roadway width has been started. So if your girder is anywhere inside the curve, then this DE is considered as positive. But if it is outside the curve like this, within the roadway, it will be considered as negative. And if it is exactly at the edge, it will be zero. For this particular case, DE is considered as zero. Now for the lateral distribution factors for the interior beams, mean for the stringers, you have to be consider directly the expressions given in ASHTO. Okay, so the reference of these are the ASHTO specifications. For the one design lane loaded, for movement and for shear, these expressions are different. For two design lanes and more than two design lanes, for movement and shear, expressions are different. Okay, this G is very important. This is the distribution factor. Okay, so if the lateral distribution has been done for the longitudinal beams, means stringers, then we have discussed earlier for one dimensional analysis, for the proximate method of analysis and design, you have to be considered first the lateral distribution. And this lateral distribution you can consider in the form of lateral distribution factor. One factor has been calculated by using these expressions given in this slide, and these G factor has been multiplied with the actual loads to get an equivalent loads. Okay, this lateral distribution factor are multiplied with the actual loads, live loads, to get the equivalent loads from the lateral direction, and those value of the load has been applied in the along the length of the member, and then longitudinal distribution has been done. Okay, so very first step is for the longitudinal members, those are spanning along the length of the bridge, means stringers specifically, you have to be calculate the lateral distribution factors. This G is 0.06 plus S over 4300 raised to power 0.4, capital S over L raised to power 0.3, kg over LT S cube into 0.1. Okay, and for the shear, the expression is this one. For this, only one condition needed to be satisfied, that once you are calculating the kg, okay, mean the equivalent moment of inertia of the beams by considering the different materials for beam and for the slab and the beam, this kg, it value should be in between 4 into 10 raised to power 9 and 3 into 10 raised to power 12. When you are going to be use these expressions, when kg is from 4 into 10 raised to power 9 to 3 into 10 raised to power 12. So in between this, you have to satisfy. Then comes lateral distribution factors for the interior beam. Two or more design lanes loaded for the movements and for the shear. So again, expression is given for here also, the same kg limitation has been given. Now lateral distribution factor for the exterior beam. For the exterior beam, this DE distance is very important. This distance DE shall be taken as positive if the exterior web is within the roadway, and negative if it is outside the roadway. Okay, so I have told you the expression given below are applicable for the concrete deck on the steel or the concrete beams. So the limitations are that, for the expressions we will discuss ahead, that your DE should be greater than and less than minus 300 and less than and equal to 910 millimeter. This 910 is the the overhanging or this DE distance limitation for the using the approximate method. So for the exterior beams, for the main girders, one design lane loaded, for movement and for the shear, you have to use the lever rule. how we are going to be use a liver rule once we are going to be design going to be solve an example problem, then we will see. Two or more design lanes loaded. Okay, if two or more design lanes are loaded, then this G can be calculated by calculating first of all G interior by using the previous expression and multiplying it with another factor that is small e. What this small e is? This small e is all depending on this overhanging or this DE distance. 0.77 plus DE over 2800 should be greater than equal to 1. If it is less than 1, at least you have to be consider it equal to 1. Okay, so for the shear, same, E is multiplied with the G interior. G interior has been calculated, mean interior beams. So in the last slides, previous slides, we have calculated G interior by using the previous expression. Then multiplied with the E. Small e is 0.6 plus D over 3000. There is no limitation, whatever the value, it will be going to be taken as it is and going to be multiplying with the G interior. And this G is used for the shear loads. Then comes a transverse load. Last distribution factors we have considered for exterior and interior beams along the length. Now the in the transverse direction, floor beams has been placed. So for the floor beams, if the transverse floor beam are directly supporting the decks, the distribution factors are given in ASHTO specification. However, if the floor beams are taking the load only from the longitudinal place stringers, then the liver rule may be used to get the distribution factors. Okay, so these are two different things. I have told you that there are two cases that whether your deck slab is placing their loads directly on the floor beams and floor beam is resting on the longitudinal members. Okay, and longitudinal members are resting on the piers or the columns. And second case is when your bridge deck has been transferring the load on the stringers on the floor beams, and floor beams on the main girder and main girder on the foundation or the pier. Okay, so if this is the particular case, the first one is when your deck slab is directly placing the load on the floor beams, then the ASHTO specification, the factors are given. And once we are going to be do this type of the example, then you have to go to the ASHTO specification. That is generally not used. Majority of the cases, the floor beams are taking load from the longitudinal placed stringers. Okay, generally. And majority of the aapne bhi yahi karna hai when you are going to be design your problem, then you have to be consider that your floor beams are taking loads from the stringers and then those are transferring towards the main girders. Okay, so for that liver rules is a simple equilibrium equation in which you are considering one pivot point and you are calculating the unknowns by using the movements about that pivot point. Okay, that is liver rule. That is not difficult task, simple. Movement equilibrium you have to be established for the load supplied, vehicular load supplied, live load supplied, and we will do it well when we will do the example problem. Next is the deflection check. Finally, so once you are going to be deciding with the loads, so with respect to these loads, the dimension of the design has been done. Analysis of the load, beam design is not a difficult task. We will not going to be do that particular part. I am not going to be guide you for that particular part once we are going to be solve our numerical problem, because how to design a beam once the shear and the movement values, mean MU and VU, is with you. Okay, after the analysis, load analysis, all of the load analysis, if once the MU mean shear and the movement is with you, then for the beam you can design a beam by yourself. Okay, aap LRFT manuals ko use karte hue, properties beam ko use karte hue, you can very easily design your beams. Okay, that will not be a part of that. We are going to skipping that part to design a plate girder, to design the stringers beams, to design the floor beams. We will only going to be focused on the bridge deck slab design and the analysis part, analysis of the loads in terms of shear, in terms of movement. Finally, you will be given an instructions to calculate, to determine the MU and VU, and how to use this MU and MU to design your beam. That will not be instructed to you or guided to you. Okay, finally, once you are, you will be done the by using this distribution factors, the lateral distribution of the live loads, the longitudinal distribution of the live loads, by considering the lean load effects, by considering the dynamic impact loads, by considering the dynamic allowance, by considering the impact factors. All of these factors, once been included, been considered while calculating the loads, final loads in terms of MU and VU, then you can design the beams by yourself. And finally, the checks has been applied. And within those checks, for the bridge, the deflection checks are certain different. Okay? The deflection checks in the bridges is optional, but shall always be performed for the live loads alone. Okay? Because live loads is certain uncertain type of the loading. That is in going to give you a variant type of the load. Variant loads are those type of the loads. Those are going to change its location and its magnitude while moving along that path. Okay, so that's why this is a part of a variant load. So variant loads are always very important and critical in all of the respects. So for the deflection checks, these live loads are very important. The large deflection out of the following cases is considered. The deflection due to design truck loads alone, but including the dynamic load allowance along with the truck load. 1/4 of the above deflection plus the deflection due to the design lane loads, you have to be considered. The maximum allowable live load deflections may be as under: only vehicular loads on the roadway span, that is divided span, roadway that is spanned by 800. Pedestrian load is present with or without the other load, then the deflections, maximum deflection is equal to span over 1000. Vehicular load on cantilever arms, then span over 300. Pedestrian load on cantilever arm, then span over 375. These are the maximum allowable live load deflections under different circumstances. So whatever the case you are solving, that is under your consideration, according to that, you have to be take out that maximum allowable live load deflection. So in place of checking the actual live load deflections, following optional criteria for span to depth ratios may be utilized. So if your S is the slab length and your L is the span length of the beams, then the reinforced concrete slabs for the simple span deflections can be calculated by this formula, and for the continuous span, the deflection can be checked or can be calculated by using this formula. That should be greater than or equal to 165. If not, then at least equal to 165. So the previous slides was for the slab deflection check. Now this slide is for the deflection check of for the beam. So depth of the I-beam portion of composite I-beam. Okay, how to calculate that? Then you can calculate the deflections. For the simple spans, this depth can be calculated, mean deflection can be calculated by 0.033L. And for the continuous span, it will be 0.027L. And for trusses, it will be 0.1L. Instead of the beams, girders, if you are placing the trusses, then for the trusses, this deflection should be equal to 0.1 into L. Okay, so these values you have to be keep remember for the deflection checks given in the previous slide for the slab deflection and here for the beam girder and the trusses deflection. Okay, and in detail also we will discuss in the later half of this topic. So till now we have been discussed the analysis part. Okay, by following the proximate method of analysis, one dimensional analysis, which type of the factors you have to be consider for the load analysis, and then finally for the deflection checks. Okay, that we have been discussed today. And in the next part, we will going to be start directly with the design of the deck slab. Okay, so first of all, go through with it. The first part, mean the part where we have been discussed the different definitions, and then connecting with that, now today in this particular part we have been discussed in detail about the load analysis by following the approximate method of analysis for the bridge deck and for the beams also, for the floor beams and for the stringers. So then we may have in the next week online session. First of all, till that particular part we will going to be have an online session, and your all of the queries and your questions I am going to be take up, and then we will clear all of these points till that particular part of our lecture, and then we are going to be start with the design of a deck slab.